We get the view from the hill. Our regular Tuesday MPs are scattered all over the country during prorogation. We couldn't get them all together except for conservative voice of reason MP James Rajat from Edmonton. In today's Liberal Corner is BC MP Joyce Murray here in the studio. Our common sense NDPer is Malcolm Allen. Welcome to you all. James, I guess I want to go to you first on this veterans charter. There's some people that are worried this is just talk and not anyone, no one's walking. Are you pretty convinced from your side that the veterans charter is going to be dealt with once and for all, finally?
I am, Don. In fact, and as your interview with the Ombudsman pointed out, he said it's a very comprehensive report that they've looked at over a number of months and years here. So I think it is appropriate, as Minister Fantino said, to have an all-party committee review the findings of his report, his recommendations, and make recommendations to the minister in terms of what action needs. We have invested monies, I mean, as recently as last year's budget, towards veterans in terms of improving their benefits. Obviously, more needs to be done here, and that's why we do welcome the report by the Ombudsman, and I look forward to the committees examining that and reporting that to Parliament.
Is that good enough for you, Joyce Murray?
No, it's not, Don. This is a huge embarrassment for Canada. I don't think there's a single Canadian that can support the fact that our most affected veterans, people who are severely and permanently incapacitated, lose almost half of their benefits at age 65. And families, of course, as Sean was saying earlier, suffer a lot when their family member is severely incapacitated. These things should have been corrected by now. They were discussed in a committee that I sat in on probably 2 years ago. Why is the government not acted? The cost would be minimal. And I did a rough calculation that to extend those benefits past 65 for those hundreds that would lose them would essentially cost Canadians approximately 2 cents each per month to do the right thing to those veterans.
Okay, let's have your 2 cents worth.
Well, clearly this government has failed veterans. I mean, it is an issue that they have literally known about. It's been studied in the past. It's an issue about whether you want to correct it. And the government clearly has not taken the onus here and made those corrections. You know, my colleague Peter Stauffer, who's our veterans critic, has been on this file for a long, long time and has said from the day that you enter the forces up until the time that we tend your gravestone, we owe a debt. And clearly this government has not taken on that obligation of that debt. And now's the time for this government to step up. We don't need a further review. Clearly the recommendations are there. Act. Now's the time for action.
Interesting point, James. I want to quickly go back to you on this before I move along to a different topic, in that this is a government that always said it stood by the troops and, you know, saluted them at every opportunity. Is there a sense that you've let down the ones that paid the highest price for doing that, the service we've asked of them?
Well, absolutely not, Don. In fact, if you look at investments made over the past number of years in successive budgets, there have been attempts on behalf of the government to address all the issues with respect to veterans' benefits. Obviously, there are still some issues that we do need to address, and we will, in fact, be doing so. But that's why, I mean, the government welcomed the report that was released today, thanked the Ombudsman for his work, and will seriously look at all of the recommendations and in terms of what funding is required to address all of the issues. But I think we have to keep in mind the fact that over past successive budgets, there have been increasing investments in terms of veterans' benefits during that period of time.
Okay, Joyce Murray, I want to switch topics if I can on this one. Your leader, Justin Trudeau, has sort of put pot back on the political agenda in a big way, but Health Canada made an interesting move. Today it stopped allowing or accepting applications for individuals or small growers to grow medicinal marijuana. Now they're turning it over to large-scale grow operations. I'm wondering, is this a positive move in your view that we go big on growing marijuana for medicinal purposes, or is the existing system doing well enough?
Well, clearly, Don, the existing system is a huge failure because it's delivered the control and the profits of cannabis into the hands of the criminal underworld. And in fact, today in Vancouver, we're seeing the start of a trial where six people were killed in a violence related to the drug trade. So it's absolutely not working. I think what's interesting here is that the government is announcing, on the quiet actually, the largest initiative of legal production of cannabis in the history of Canada. Why? To have safer streets and to make it safer for Canadians. And that's exactly the argument that Justin Trudeau has been making, that we need to regulate and control this product because otherwise it's in the hands of the gangs and it's unsafe streets and it's unhealthy and accessible to young people. So we've been saying the very same thing while being attacked by the conservatives on our stand.
I guess, Malcolm, you're an agriculture critic. I guess marijuana falls under your purview now. Are they doing it the right way?
Well, I think the issue with the marijuana and how we go about using it for medicinal purposes, what we've seen over time is small growers who are actually regulated and inspected on a regular basis. In fact, they're more inspected than anyone else probably in the ag sector. And so they're only allowed, in most cases, six plants. Yeah, they're not allowed any more than two additional people they can grow for. And so what we see is a very regulated industry where folks who need that medicinal marijuana have been growing it primarily because they couldn't afford to buy it from the federal facility in the prairies. And so now what we're seeing is we're going to have this so-called free market, they say, but only if you happen to get a license and you grow it in a big plant. You don't have a free market when it comes to the individual who can grow the six plants and continue to be able to sustain themselves. Mm-hmm. So this is a medicinal issue. This isn't about, you know, growing marijuana for the sake of growing marijuana.
James, your thoughts on this issue?
Well, and as Malcolm pointed out, it's important to point out this is for medicinal purposes. I mean, obviously, it's a challenge for the government in terms of managing this program. Health Canada has reviewed the program quite extensively, both from a production and from a distribution point of view. So it's changing both aspects. I mean, it's trying to bring it more under sort of the traditional healthcare system. And it's also looking and responding, I think, to some of the concerns that Joyce raises in terms of some of the elements that are getting into the model as it's currently instituted. So that's why the government is looking at it from a public safety perspective in terms of going to larger type facilities to produce it. And again, for medicinal purposes. I think I wouldn't agree with her in terms of analogy with respect to legalizing in total. I think we can have a legitimate discussion in terms of marijuana and consider things that some of the police chiefs are recommending in terms of ticketing. But I don't think because we're changing the model for medicinal purposes that we ought to go down the road of legalization of marijuana.
Okay, I want to quickly move along.
Don,
we only got a minute left,
and
very quickly, Joyce.
Yeah, if it holds true for medicinal, it holds true for recreational. That having government control and regulation is safer for Canadians.
Okay, quickly, go around. Well, you got 10 seconds each.
I respond to that.
They want to change the national anthem. They want to put "Thy Son's Command" out and put in doused something or other, gender neutral on that. Should we change the lyrics to our national anthem, yes or no, Joyce Murray?
Well, personally, I would like that change. Is it the biggest priority for Canadians? Probably not at this time with all the other challenges we face.
James Rajat.
No, I think we should keep the anthem as it is. There was a suggestion of changing, I think, back in 2010, and Canadians were loud and clear at that time that they wanted the anthem kept as is.
Okay. Margaret, I would disagree with you. What do you say?
Well, clearly, when the Conservatives tried this once before, the greatest number of emails I ever received was actually